أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك وأناخت برحلك. عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين وعلى أخته العقيلة زينب وأخيه أبا الفضل العباس ورحمة الله وبركاته. عظم الله أجورنا وأجوركم بمصاب سيدنا ومولانا أبا عبد الله الحسين سيد الشهداء وسيد شباب أهل الجنة. السلام عليكم dear brothers and sisters ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to lesson number 8. In this lesson, inshallah, we will be focusing on the life of Imam Zain al-Abidin Ali ibn al-Husayn alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam. The learning objectives of this lesson is number 1, an introduction into the life of Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. Number 2 is an introduction to as-sahifa as-sajjadiyya. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam is our fourth Imam. His father, Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, taught him all the knowledge that had been passed down to him by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam and his father, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. So, in many of these lessons, inshallah, we will continue, even though this is lesson number 8 and we just have one more lesson left of the series of Hussein's stars. Later on, inshallah, we will go through the 14 infallibles. You find that these lessons have this part of the lesson that is called key facts. I call them personally the ID cards of the infallibles. These ID cards has some of the information of an infallible: the birth date, the father, the mother, and the wafat. Also, with other PDF files and other lessons, inshallah, we will include the period of the imamah and the place of the burial. So, with Imam Zain al-Abidin, the birthday of the imam is on the 5th of Sha'ban, 38th year after Hijrah in Medina al-Munawwara. We discussed this in the previous lessons that we said in the month of Sha'ban, we have many birthdays. One of the birthdays of the ones that we celebrate in the month of Sha'ban, Sha'ban is a month that comes before the month of Ramadan, is the birthday of Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam. In addition to that, we have the birthday of Imam al-Husayn, we have the birthday of Ali al-Akbar, we have the birthday of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, we have the birthday of Imam al-Hujja ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-Sharif in the month of Sha'ban. And there is no wafat in the month of Sha'ban, only birthdays that we celebrate in the month of Sha'ban. We will, inshallah, have a lesson in regards to the months and the celebration that we have of the birthdays of the or the A'yad, and of course the martyrdoms and the commemoration. Inshallah, we'll discuss that in another lesson that we will dedicate a special class for that. I have done this in my school in Imam Ali College with the youngsters many times for them to know more about the months that comes on. When it comes to the English months, as some call them, the English months, for example, in February, people know February has Valentine. In December, people know the occasions in December. They know the birthday of Jesus, for example, that is Christmas, and so on and so forth. Of course, in the Islamic calendar, especially the Shia Islamic calendar, we have more birthdays and martyrdoms and commemorations of any other groups or religious groups in the world, more than any. We celebrate birthdays more than any other. And that's the answer for some people that say, oh, the Shia, they just do martyrdoms, they just cry, they just beat their chest. No, we have birthdays more than any other groups. We have birthdays more than any other religions. We celebrate the birthdays of 14 infallibles. 14 infallibles. In addition to it, we celebrate the three A'yad, Eid al-Fitr, Eid al-Adha, and Eid al-Ghadir. In addition to that, we celebrate every Friday. Every Friday, that today is Friday, we celebrate the day of Friday. That is why we have Ghusl al-Jum'ah, and it's mustahab for you to wear something clean or something new, to recite Dua al-Nutba, to go to Salat, Salat al-Jum'ah. So we have birthdays more than any other. And of course, we have commemorations, we have martyrdoms, that we commemorate the martyrdoms of the 14 infallibles minus one, that is the Imam of our time, the awaited Imam. We don't commemorate the martyrdom of Imam al-Hujjah because he's still alive, he's not martyred. So the rest, we commemorate their martyrdoms. So if someone comes and tells you that you Shia, you always cry and you always depressed, that's not true at all. Continuing with the lesson, the father of the Imam alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam is none other than Imam al-Husayn alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam. Imam al-Husayn, our third Imam, is the father of our fourth Imam. Now, just a quick question. Was Imam Zain al-Abidin the eldest son, the eldest child of Imam al-Husayn? No. Ali ibn al-Husayn, aka Ali al-Akbar, is actually older than Imam Zain al-Abidin. For some people that think, oh, the elder son becomes the Imam after. No, it's not like that. Allah chooses the Imams. Allah chooses the Imams, not people. We don't elect the Imams. It's not because of their age or because we like how they look. No. Allah chooses the Imams. Allah wants Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn, Zain al-Abidin, to be the Imam. Ali al-Akbar, even though he's older than Imam Zain al-Abidin and he was martyred on the day of Ashura, Allah did not choose him as an Imam. Allah chose Imam Zain al-Abidin to be the Imam. So the mother of the Imam is Sayyida Shahrbanu. She was a Persian princess, Shahrbanu. The Imam married her after she was brought down to Medina. This lady, this mu'minah, the Imam married her and she bared him a child, and that is Imam Zain al-Abidin Ali ibn al-Husayn. And we have narrations that on the day that she gave birth to the Imam, she passed away. The wafat of the Imam, or the martyrdom of the Imam, is on the 25th Muharram, 25th Muharram, 95 AH in Medina. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam was present in Karbala when his father Imam al-Husayn was killed, and we just commemorated the day of Ashura. For some it was yesterday, Thursday, and for some it was today, the martyrdom of Imam al-Husayn, that we call it Ashura, the 10th, and we discussed that in our previous lesson. He was 23 years old at the time, Imam Zain al-Abidin Ali ibn al-Husayn alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam. But he was very ill. He was very sick on the day. Some people, they question, why wasn't the Imam fighting? Why didn't the Imam fight? Because of his sickness. Imam Zain al-Abidin, he had a condition, and that was dryness. The Imam could not intake any water or any food. He could not eat anything or drink anything. And he was very, very sick. And the Imam actually, when he heard his father calling out, Ala min nasirin yansuruna, ala min mu'inin yu'inuna, the Imam al-Husayn, Sayyid al-Shuhada, when he was calling for help, Imam Zain al-Abidin, even though he was sick, he took his sword and he dragged himself out of the tent to come to the aid of his father. But Imam al-Husayn alayhi afdhalu salati wa salam, Sayyid al-Shuhada, he ordered his sister, Lady Zainab salamullahi alayha, to take back his son to the khaymah, to the tent and he said to her, let him go back. He's the last of the man of this family and he's the imam after me and he should be alive. And that is why one of the reasons that Lady Zainab, she kept him alive. Of course, she's the aunt of Imam Zain al-Abidin. And of course, she knows that the imam is the imam after Imam al-Hussein. She kept him alive. And we have a hadith that says that when Shimr, alayhi la'ainullah, he attacked the tents, he came into the tent of Imam al-Sajjad and he saw him laying down on the plains of Karbala alive. So he attacked him and he was about to kill Imam al-Sajjad, Imam Zain al-Abidin, to which Lady Zainab, she came into the tent and she threw herself on the Imam and she said to Shimr, if you want to kill him, then kill me first. Other soldiers, they came into the tent and they said, you are not allowed to kill any other man. That's it, you killed Hussein, it's enough. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he kept the Imam safe. So the Imam was very ill on the day of Ashura and he could not fight the enemies. Imam Zain al-Abidin lived for 34 years after Karbala, during which time he used to teach people and guide them to Islam. So 34 years is the time of the Imamah of Imam Zain al-Abidin. The Imamah of Imam Zain al-Abidin was 34 years. And Imam Zain al-Abidin, for that time, we will go through of what the Imam did and what he saw is appropriate for that time and is needed by the people and is necessary for the people. So 34 years after Karbala, during the time, which time he used to teach people and guide them to Islam. He worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much that he was called Zain al-Abidin, which means what? Zain al-Abidin, the beauty of the worshippers. Zain al-Abidin means the beauty of the worshippers. Or in another word, adornment of the worshippers. And also, Sayyidu Sajideen, which means the master of those who do sajda. Sometimes people could call him a sajjad. And people used to call him a sajjad, would call him a sajjad. And we also today, we call him Imam al-Sajjad. The one who prostrates, I mean do sajda, which also means one who does sajda a lot. Every time Imam Zain al-Abidin remembered some favor of or blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Imam used to, he performed sajda immediately to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should learn this from the Imam. When a ni'mah comes to us, a blessing comes to us, we should also do the sajda that is called sajda al-shukr. And the Imam used to do that a lot. And the Imam, of course, definitely was and known is as the Imam of the ones who prostrate a lot and the ones who do ibadah, worship Allah a lot. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam constantly mourned for his father and kept the memory of the tragedy of Karbala alive. He did this by organizing majalis for the martyrs of Karbala. We follow the teaching of the Imam until today by attending majalis for Imam al-Hussein. There are some people that, I don't know what you want to call them, they don't have that much intellect. That's the best way of putting it. They come and they say, oh, you Shia, you are like women crying and crying and crying for the Imam that was killed a long time ago. And here you come to the Imam's life, Imam Zain al-Abidin, and you see that an Imam, a brave Imam, a courageous Imam, and that is Imam Zain al-Abidin, he cries for his father 34 years. We follow the path of our Imams. Like Imam Zain al-Abidin cried for his father, we cry. Like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet, when he cried for the demise of his sons, we cry. Like Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, who cried for the demise, for the martyrdom of his wife, Lady Fatima al-Zahra, we follow the Imam أمير المؤمنين, commander of the faithful, and we cry like Imam al-Hasan al-Mujtaba عليه أفضل الصلاة والسلام, when he cried for the martyrdom of his brother Imam al-Hussein, and he foretold his brother saying لا يومك يومك يا أبا عبد الله. We follow the footsteps of Imam al-Hasan al-Mujtaba and the footsteps of Lady Fatima al-Zahra after the martyrdom of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. She cried so much that she was called what? One of the Bakkain, the one who cries a lot. And who is greater than Lady Fatima al-Zahra salamullahi alayha, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. The people of Medina, continuing the lesson, the people of Medina respected the Imam very much. One day during Hajj, Hisham ibn Abdul Malik, the ruler of the time, tried to Taj Hajar al-Aswad. To Taj Hajar al-Aswad. We also call Hajar al-Aswad the stone that is on the Kaaba, Hajar al-As'ad, the black stone. The black stone in the corner of the Kaaba. We call it Hajar al-As'ad. But could not get near the Kaaba because of the large crowd gathered for Hajj. With all the bodyguard and the soldiers surrounding him and pushing people right and left, he couldn't reach Hajar al-As'ad. Then he was waiting. He saw the crowd move away and make a path for one man. To come and touch the black stone. This was Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam. This made Hisham very angry and jealous, and he decided to poison the Imam. Imam As-Sajjad Zainul Abidin, he came by himself. No guards, no soldiers, no people pushing people around. Move. No. The Imam came by himself and he walked, and they made for him a path. The Imam went and he did the ziyara, he did the tawaf, he touched Hajar al-As'ad, and the Imam moved along. And here, Hisham, when he saw that, he was very upset and he started plotting to kill the Imam. The Imam was 57 years old when Hisham poisoned him. Imam passed away on the 25th of Muharram and is buried in Jannatul Baqi' in Medina. As I promised, inshallah, we have a lesson talking about the cities in which the Imams are buried in, the infallibles, the Imams are buried in. So if you go inshallah to Ziyarat al-Arba'een, after people they finish the marasim commemorating the martyrdom of Imam al-Hussein on Ashura, they start making their way to the road that is from Najaf to Karbala, most of the mawakib. They start going there and they start preparing for what? For the Ziyarat Arba'een. If you go there in this time, you see people also preparing a food. It's called Ash. They prepare this food in the time, in the dates that leads to the martyrdom of Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. If you inshallah go there, you see people, they walk toward the Ziyarah of Arba'een. Some people, they start working from those days. Some people, they come after, because Ziyarat Arba'een is on the 20th of Safar. So some people do it before the martyrdom of Imam. Some people do it after. But if you go inshallah, you see in Najaf, in Karbala, even in the road between Najaf and Karbala, this path, you see people preparing ash and they commemorating the martyrdom of Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. Did you know Imam Zain al-Abidin has said, do not keep friends with five types of people. One, a liar, an open sinner, a miser, a foolish person, and a person who breaks relations with his or her family. So this should be a guideline for those people who want to make friends. And it's important that you make friends. So the Imam says, don't make friends with liars. Because if he lies about anything, he will also lie to you. He will also lie to you. An open sinner, the one who doesn't care of the sins and the torments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he does all sorts of sins, openly. Don't befriend that person. A miser, a foolish person. A foolish person means an ahmak, and a person who breaks relations with his or her family. قاطع الرحم. It's not advisable to make friends with them because you're encouraging them to do so. If you see, for example, let's go talking about the open sinners. If you see someone from your friends and you find out later they're open sinners, you should definitely show that you do not approve of their lifestyle and the sins they are doing. Because if you show any, you know, friendship to this person at this time, after knowing that this person is an open sinner, this person takes more of, you know, freedom doing sins. But if you show him that you are disgusted by his acts, definitely that's going to put a stop to this person if he cares about the friendship. Now, الصحيفة السجادية. As I discussed, Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam, when he saw after the martyrdom of his father, people are either don't have enough of trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them, or they don't know the rights of one another, or the imam saw, all imams when they see in their time there is a specific needs for the people, they target that need. And that's what Imam Zain al-Abidin did. So when the imam saw that they don't know the rights of one another, or they don't know the rights of their own body, of their tongue, of their eye, the imam came with a charter of rights. The charter of rights, 51 rights. The imam spoke about 51 rights. In it, you find haqqul um, haqqul ab, haqqul bat, haqqul faraj, haqqul muallim, so on and so forth. 51 rights. It's called charter of rights. You can download it from the internet, PDF version, Arabic and English, and you can read it in your free time. Also, the imam saw that people are not that much having trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them. And people are going away from Allah's mercy. And they thinking, Allah doesn't forgive me. That's it. There's no forgiveness from Allah. So the imam compiled a book that is called Sahifa Sajjadiyya. One of the greatest collection of the teachings of Imam Zain al-Abidin is a book called Sahifa Sajjadiyya. It's a collection, this is a collection of ad'iyya, that is the plural of du'a, du'a meaning supplications, supplications, du'a, like du'a Kumail, du'a al-Nudba. Those are for other imams, but for the imam, Imam Zain al-Abidin, he came on with Sahifa Sajjadiyya, a book of supplications, a book of ad'iyya. In addition to that, there is also a du'a called du'a Abi Hamza al-Thamali. We recite this du'a every month of Ramadan. The night that we all gather to recite it together, it's a night of Qadr. We call it the night of Qadr. We recite du'a Abi Hamza al-Thamali. So this is a collection of ad'iyya, plural of du'a and munajat taught by the imam alayhi afdhalus salati was salam. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam was not able to give lectures in public due to the political situation at the time. You know, it was very hard at the time. Yazid ibn Muawiyah, he continued ruling for another 2 years after killing Imam al-Hussein. And in that time, he burned the Kaaba. In that time, he killed many of the companions of the Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. Many of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam were killed in Medina. So Imam didn't give that much lectures. So what the Imam did was Sahifa Sajjadiyya, Rasalat al-Huquq. And now we're going to talk about another one after finishing this paragraph. So, was not able to give lectures in public due to the political situation at the time. So, he taught his followers through these ad'iyya and munajat. The imam also has a document in which he has listed the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as I discussed, and the rights of the other people on every Muslim. For example, it discusses the rights of the parents, the rights of the neighbors, the rights of the friends, the rights of your body, and so on. This beautiful document is also called, this is the one I spoke about, رسالة الحقوق, the Charter of Rights. So what was the third thing that the Imam did? The Imam used to, of course, in those days, it was, you know, very normal to sell slaves in the market. You go, because of one war between the Muslims and another tribe or another nation, after winning the war, they bring a lot of men and women and they sell them as slaves. The Imam used to buy these slaves from Africa, from all around the world. The Imam used to buy them and the Imam used to educate them to the part these people become scholars. And then the Imam, he used to set them free. Go. In addition to that, the Imam used to give them good amounts of money, because he's a slave. He was just freed. He doesn't have any income or any money. The Imam used to give them good amount of money. You go back to your home country and go there, preach, go there and teach people about Islam. So the Imam used to give them money, set them free. After these people used to become scholars by the teachings of the Imam. Just imagine if you sit with the Imam every day, if you just look at the Imam every day, if you listen to the Imam every day, 1 year, 2 year, 3 years, you become a scholar and you go and you preach. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam said, do good to others when they ask you for help, even if they are not deserving of it. This is a very important thing, because many people, they say, I did for this fulan, for that person, a lot of good deeds. I did a lot of things for them, but they don't appreciate it. If you did it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, continue doing it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The key facts and the summary are also, inshallah, this document is going to be on the Imam Ali College website in the Muharram section. You can download it and you can read it through or teach it to others if you like. And of course, you can do the summary, the key points in your spare time. هذا والحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة والسلام على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين.